Hello, this is Daryl Ehrlich, and this is the Vietnam Voices series, a project by the Billings Gazette, and I am happy today. It is November 18th. Wow, how time flies. November 18th, 2015, and we are here in the studios of the Billings Gazette, and I have with me John E. Howard. He was with the U.S. Army from 1967 to 1970. Now, his story is a little bit different than most of the ones that we heard. Most of the Vietnam vets, with the exception of a couple, have been over in Vietnam. He's got a little different story to tell. He did something that I think most of us understand intellectually was part of the war, which is helping to bury those who died in war. But he has one, and I'll let him explain it in a very real way. John, thank you for being
here. You're welcome, sir.
Let's talk a little bit about, now you were in from 1967 to 1970, but let's talk about right before 1967, where were you and what were you doing?
I had graduated from school in Tampa, Florida, did a semester of college, quickly ran out of money. I decided to join the Army, where I told my dad they would treat an 18-year-old like a man. Boy, did I find out that was different. Went to Fort Benning. My scores qualified me for officer candidate school, and so I decided to ride with the flow. Went through a special part of Fort Benning in basic, then went to Fort Lewis for advanced infantry training for OCS, for officer candidate school. Went through that, and then at the end, my first sergeant told me that the Army did not want 18-year-old lieutenants. So he said, we got to find some place for you. Apparently an opening had come up, and I was told to volunteer for it with the old guard. I had no idea what that was.
And said, what is the old guard?
He said, it's the Army's honor guard at Arlington National Cemetery. And I said, boy, is that got to be a gravy job. You just sit back, do a few ceremonies, and wow. Turned out it was the furthest thing from the truth. 6 days a week, you were up at 5 a.m. to 5 p.m., fully dressed up in ceremonial uniforms in the heat. It became so warm that you would sweat through your clothes, of course, and your clothes would develop a white patina. And, of course, the next morning, you had fresh clothes on. Turned out it was very expensive. You had to buy two brand-new sets of boots. You had to buy two brand-new low-quarter shoes and then have them modified in a special way so that you had horseshoe plates on them. You wore those constantly. The boots for training or PT. And the low-quarter shoes for ceremonies. Plus, you had to buy at least five sets of fatigue uniforms because you wore a new uniform every day. And you had to either press it yourself or have it professionally pressed. So that all involves money when you're only making $79 a month. Plus you had a certain cadre. The NCOs were very, very professional, and this was the old Army where it wasn't unusual to have a man with 20 years in and he was only a PFC because he had been up and down the ranks so many times. But he was still a good soldier, even though he had, no doubt, a drinking problem. So we had those guys also with us. And one of the hardest things was the wear and tear on one's body when you have to pick up 10 to 15 coffins a day. And the Vietnam coffins, you needed eight people to, because for some reason the guys coming back from Vietnam were buried in lead-lined caskets. We've never figured out the reason why. But we also had to do a lot of funerals where you might have six guys buried in two coffins. And so you have the families of these six guys or eight guys, nine guys, and there are... It was extremely sad, but you could not let that show. You had to be totally professional at all times. And part of the physical problems was, an example was carrying a coffin to the lowering device, and your balancing on 2x4s that were just thrown down with steel plates. We had a sister company drop 2 coffins and the entire funeral party into a hole at Arlington. But that does happen. I mean, the ground gives way on the side of it because it's very moist anyway. We did cremates. We did children. And after a while, you became, you might say, bitter. Emotionally, you were drained. You had no way of relief. We had no recreation whatsoever. We had one movie theater on base, and that showed the same movie all week. No swimming pool, no gym, nothing to do except sit around the barracks and drink a soda and polish your shoes and polish your brass and so forth. It was very disciplined. You couldn't do anything that that an ordinary soldier might, such as go out on the town, because the everybody knew from your haircut where you were from and who you were and so forth. So basically, you stayed on base. Myself, I used to do long walks through the cemetery. So I got to know the cemetery quite well. And in December of 1968, I worked the funeral of my father. We buried him Christmas Eve of 68. He had died of World War II injuries, according to the VA. So that was real rough, to say the least. Heck of a way to spend Christmas Day. But I got we got to see quite a lot. One of the things, in June of 1968, I had just made acting buck sergeant. And I was given a detail at the back lawn, or the east lawn, of the Custis Lee Mansion, which overlooks the Kennedy gravesite. We got to the site at 5:30 a.m. in full dress uniforms for Bobby Kennedy's funeral. And our job was to prevent any photographers from getting and looking down, and it's quite a slope down to the Kennedy gravesite, and to keep people away, too, because the cemetery at that time was an open cemetery. Anybody could drive in and so forth. So we did that all day, and they did not bury him until 10:30 at night because of delays with the train coming down from New York. And then they had services in D.C., and then they had a long parade coming into the cemetery. So it was very long day. Periodically, we would have a 6-passenger or a 20-passenger bus come and pick us up. The buses had no seats in them, so we had to stand. They would take us to the maintenance yard so we could use the bathroom, and then they took us to the south side of the cemetery, not far from Pershing's grave, and we were permitted to take our coats off and drape them over headstones and have sea rations for our lunch and for our supper. And one thing that was nice, though, they gave us ice-cold Cokes, and that was the best thing in the world. Nothing's ever tasted that good. But that was a long day, constantly on your feet, constantly on guard, constantly having to look your best, because if you didn't, you would have somebody talk to you later, and you did not want to have that conversation.
So let's talk a little bit about what you had your own company barber, correct?
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about, so how did you have to look? Describe, you said a little bit about I want to hear about the shoes, the uniform. How was your look regulated?
You were always having to be top-notch. First of all, no facial hair whatsoever.
Okay.
No tattoos. Generally, if you were left-handed person and you fired your weapon left-handed, they sent you to Vietnam. That was an unwritten rule. They wanted everybody right-handed. Each company had its own barber. They would draft some guy who was a barber in real life, and they would send him to his basic training, and then they would send him to our unit. He wouldn't be classified as infantry. He'd be classified as what they called garrison. He cut hair all day. We had our own barber chair. He got tipped a big whopping 25 cents for every haircut, And we had to get a haircut every Monday and Thursday or Tuesday and Friday. No exceptions. You shaved at night and you shaved in the morning. You shaved your ears. You didn't want any peach fuzz showing or any stray hairs up there. You shaved down onto your chest because you didn't want any of this hair sticking out. You also shaved far down on your back, as far back as you could reach, because you did not want any stray hairs showing. Everything was very, very well done as far as your uniforms go. We had our own steam presses. I had never steam pressed anything in my life, but you learned real quick. Everybody had their own iron, because you had to iron your T-shirts, the front end of your T-shirt that showed. And don't you dare have a grody T-shirt. No, you'd be sent out. And a lot of people didn't like this pettiness, and it was pettiness to the most extreme. So they'd go to Vietnam. They'd sign the papers and say, I've had enough of this. And 8 to 10 weeks later, we're doing their funeral. And that hits you right between the eyes. Here's this guy who used to be your bunk mate, and all of a sudden, bam, he's burying. And he's really dead for
dead is dead.
Dead is dead. And this, the finality of it all hits you. So you learn real quick to do what the NCOs told you to do. And you better do it 101%.
Did you feel relieved that you didn't have to go to Vietnam, that you were going this route?
To my dying day, I always regret not going to Vietnam. Hmm. But you got to understand, we lost over 58,000 guys and 6 women. That and the futility of war really crept in. You're burying these guys, and what did they die for? Day after day after day. And also the multiple funerals where you bury 6 guys in 2 coffins or 8 guys in 3 coffins.
And I just want to make sure, I think I get what you're saying, and I don't mean to be dense or graphic, but that's because that was all there was to bury of them? Is that why there
exactly
was 3 guys in, or 8 guys in 1 coffin or however many?
Yeah, it was either a helicopter had been hit by a missile or had exploded on the ground and burned, or they were in an APC that got hit by multiple RPGs, and they were all roasted alive. And so when the graves registration would go in, they would find the dog tags and the bones and skulls, and there was no DNA, of course, at that time. Mm-hmm. And they were put in body bags. Well, we had 6 guys, and here's 6 dog tags and 6 skulls, and we'll bury them. Same way we helped the Navy do the Oriskany. They had a fire aboard Oriskany, and I think they had 4 coffins and like 28 guys or something like that. It was just, you know, phenomenal that the horrible way for these poor schmucks to have died. I mean, and it kind of destroyed you emotionally. Plus being on one of the crazy things on funeral detail is after you passed the physical requirements, you had to walk a certain way. We get rid of a lot of people because they didn't know how to do the walk.
What is it? So, describe that walk for me.
If you've ever seen the guy who does the tomb guard, when he walks, he doesn't move his shoulders at all. He walks like you're carrying a pan of water. That's how we trained. You would go back and forth with a small cake pan filled with water, called a slide and glide. And some guys just bounce. You can't do that. Boom, you're gone. So after all that was done, then your final initiation was you had to spend the night in a training coffin in the basement, which was rather unnerving.
Slow that one down. While you spent the night in a training coffin.
Yeah. We had several coffins that had been donated by various funeral homes. And there was one that they used to initiate the new guys to grave duty. And that was you would sleep in the coffin, and you had 2 clamps that you would clamp over the edge of the coffin so nobody could close the lid and sit on it and suffocate you. Plus, you had the guy who was charge of quarters. He kept an eye on you all night, too. I went in, took two Tylenol, which made me sleepy, grabbed my old army blanket, laid down, and I went to sleep, slept like a big dog, and then 5 a.m. they woke me up. And a lot of guys couldn't do that.
I was going to say mentally that that would be a terrible thing for some people.
Oh, it bothers me to this day.
Yeah.
Very much. But so does seeing something. We were at a funeral home in preparation for an officer's funeral. And we're just standing around in the home. And the funeral director says, see what we're burying today. And in the casket was a full-dressed blue uniform with the medals and everything else. It was just laid out. And in the middle was a nice wooden box. And inside that box was a man's left hand with his wedding band on it, because that's all they found of the guy. And you see that and you go, and become coarse to that. Some guys did.
Yeah.
We tried to show the, you know, all the necessary respect. But, I mean, these guys are dead. And you have the wailing going on and the crying and all that emotion really draws on you.
And you don't, and you can't make, right? I mean, you can't show anything.
No.
How do you practice or drill for that? How do you, when people are crying or when you see only a hand, I mean, I think it's, I think anybody would be touched or moved by that. So how do you practice not to show anything?
You keep everything inside, because if you do, that would show weakness. And don't you let any of our senior NCOs know that you were weak in the slightest. Just like if they even suspected you were doing any marijuana, which became big at that time, you were out the door that day to Vietnam.
So that threat of Vietnam was always hanging over your head. That was the stick that they used. It's a big stick.
It is a big stick, especially when you're burying guys who you just saw 2 months ago.
Right.
And you drank beer with them, you maybe played some volleyball with them, and all of a sudden, bang, they're not here anymore. They're permanently dead. And whether they say they're going to rise again, these guys haven't risen in 45 years or 50 years. What did they die for?
Yeah.
And it just, we're not fighting for freedom. You know, without being coarse,
sure.
fighting for freedom in Vietnam is like fornicating to protect virginity.
Right.
It makes no sense whatsoever. And here we bury 48,000 men. Probably that same number are going to be messed up for the rest of their life with PTSD and all kinds of other mental issues and physical issues. And you see this day in, day out. And the finality of death is what really bothered us. And then at the same token, you go, and next day you do a parade, and you see these phony generals and colonels up there who are retiring, and they want to thank their dog and, silliness like that. And it just, there's a yin and yang in the whole thing. You go, these guys are dying, and you're standing here, and you've never even been overseas in your entire career, and you're going to retire at $100,000 a year. And you're thanking your flipping dog. So.
That's hard. That's really, it's upsetting. Especially to see them juxtaposed so closely together.
Yeah.
So how did you, even when you're in the barracks and you're together, could you even talk about it or discuss it? There was no discussion of this. So even if you were drinking a soda, you couldn't say, that's a crock.
Well, we all kind of knew it, and we were, you would talk about other things, maybe about, we had some apartments out off base, and there were some parties out there, and, naturally you get young girls looking for, mates and so forth, but so you had to be careful about that. Your off-duty time, you spend a lot of the time getting your uniform ready, pressing it, getting your shoes ready, polishing your brass, a million things. Here's an example.
Sure.
When you get dressed in the morning, do you tape your underwear to your body?
No. You would. No, I, why?
You would, first of all, put your boxers on and tape your boxers to your waist. Then you put your T-shirt on and tape your T-shirt to your boxers. Then you would put your black socks on and tape them, and they had to be up over the calf, tape them with masking tape so that they won't fall down during the course of the day. And then you, we had a little set of steps, three steps, four steps, and a chinning bar. You'd go and chin yourself, and then your dresser, this is the guy who's light duty or something that hurt his back, he would put your trousers underneath you, and you would lower yourself into your trousers. That's either fatigues or dress pants. And then he would help you with your shirt. Generally, once you put your pants on, you didn't have a belt, you wore suspenders, and then you would put your shirt on, and you would tape all that to one another, because it's going to be not shown. And then you put your tie on, that's taped, so that your tie wouldn't shift during the course of the day.
Hmm.
And then he would help you with your hat because you don't want to break your elbows. So, yeah. And then we'd walk like ducks. And we had a handicap ramp to the bus.
That just had so you, and that's so that you don't put a crease in
the pants bus. Or crease anywhere.
And you don't have seats on the bus because you don't want to sit down, right?
You better not sit down. You put a crease in your pants. And the sergeant does not want to see that. Because we had, this was, like I'm saying, a different kind of army than what other guys would experience. If you had, let's say the first sergeant found you doing something, he would come up, stand right up to you, and then give you an elbow right into the ribs. And don't you flinch. Because you know it's coming. That was normal. Totally. That's why the guys couldn't put up with this, and say, "Heck with this pettiness." I'm going to Vietnam.
I've heard a lot of Vietnam stories, and I'm almost convinced that I'm almost with those other guys.
3 a.m. We're lying in our racks. You don't ever wear sheets or blankets because it's so hot. And 3 a.m. doors fly open. Lights turned on, and platoon sergeant's there with one of our chrome-plated trash cans that we never used. They were for show only. That goes crashing into the squad bay. He wakes up the whole company, puts the whole company in the front-leaning rest position for punishment, push-up purposes, because he had found a cigarette butt in the toilet. Nobody had flushed it. That was not unusual. You just simply sit there, front-leaning rest position. After a while, you do your 20 push-ups, get back in bed, and try to go back to sleep again. Not unusual. You get used to this pettiness every day.
It seems to... how did that not make you an incredibly petty, tyrannical person yourself? You don't seem like that. Maybe I'm assuming that, but how do you not become warped by that?
In some ways, I probably am, but I've tried to control it. The Army you couldn't take any kind of drugs in the Army, but they didn't mind if you get drunk every night. But you couldn't afford to do that. And you just kept your mouth shut. We looked at it this way. You put up with this stuff, but it's better than dying. Because Private Summerfield, who was a good friend of mine, he's lying in a cold grave out there, and I'm still above the ground. So you live with it. And I actually prospered under a thing like this by keeping my mouth shut, looking the first sergeant dead in the eyes or straight ahead, whatever. Here's an example. We're doing a full-honor funeral at the old chapel at Arlington. I was in the marching platoon in front, 27 guys. I'm in the front row. All of a sudden, I feel a splat. A large bird had hit the bill of my cap and sprayed my face with white bird dropping. Had a medic come up, wipe my face. to clear my eyes and so forth. Still left the stuff on my uniform. I finished out the parade. I mean parade, the funeral, because we had to march behind the horse-drawn caisson and the caparisoned horse, which is a horse with it's boots reversed on it. It's an old thing from Genghis Khan, I guess. Anyway, after all of that's over, I get back to the barracks, and the very first thing happens is my first sergeant puts me in the front-leaning rest position. He said, "You flinched." And I said, "Yes, First Sergeant, I did flinch. I'm not going to argue with him." Did my 20 push-ups. And the guys were saying, "I don't know how you did that. Here I am splatted with bird crap. But you're not supposed to flinch." We did a funeral detail where I had we were holding the flag over the coffin. Guy right across from me, black guy, gets stung on the cheek by a bee. And as I'm watching him, he's going into anaphylactic shock, and that bee sting is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. He doesn't move a muscle. Finally, the platoon sergeant was next to me. I said, "Sergeant, you better get him a medic real quick," because his face was all swollen up. And only then did they, and the sergeant step in, they sent him off and to go sit on the bus. And the sergeant filled in for his spot. But that's not unusual. You're not supposed to. You look straight ahead. Don't let anything happen. And I don't care if even, like, when you're taking a coffin onto a gravesite, you're having all you can do to stand up. The 2x4s and 2x6s are bouncing up and down. You're trying to lift this 500-pound coffin onto a lowering device. You don't know if you're going to drop it, God forbid, if you ever did. But after you do 500 funerals, you start to not really care too much. You just want to get the job done, not get yelled at, not get screamed at. And somehow that all seemed normal to me after a while, the craziness of it all.
How many funerals would you do a day?
In 67 to 68, anybody could be buried at Arlington Cemetery, anybody who had 120 days in the Army. And so we were doing 10 to 15 at least. Most of them were servicemen, but we could also bury their wives and minor children. Of course, wives and minor children wouldn't get a flag. We called them drop jobs. And in mid-68, they decided, well, first of all, the cemeteries filled with cars all the time. We were getting traffic jams. We couldn't get to funerals. So they banned cars in the cemetery. And then they were realizing, even back in 1968, they were running out of room. So they said, well, okay, we're going to limit this to active duty or retired military. And people who had, like, the Purple Heart, Silver Star, or high government officials. That's how come Bobby Kennedy and Ted Kennedy are buried there. How Joe Lewis got buried there, I don't know. But Lee Marvin, who's buried there, he had won the Purple Heart in the Pacific, so we had no problems with him or Audie Murphy and so forth. But that was after my time. But since my parents are buried there, I, of course, still visited the cemetery.
Right. Was it, it's one thing burying a guy who has lived a good long life, but it must have been hard. Were the funerals qualitatively different for those who, the Vietnam vets, the guys who had been killed in combat recently versus the guys who had...
Oh. Well, it's not just the age factor, but, I mean, you literally had teenage wives, and they're beside themselves. And one of the great sad things is, let's say the guy got killed in Vietnam. His family decides they want him buried in Arlington, but they can't afford to go there. Because maybe they are from Seattle, let's say. So they simply ship the coffin there, and it's up to us to bury him. So what a sad factor in life. If this guy gives his life for his country, he's dead. He died in some kind of a horrible way, and he's by himself. And, that was rough, the single ones. Nobody's there to pay him any respect. That's, we would all say, thanks, buddy, and things like that. When we left, we all spoke under our breath. But, geez, I mean, day after day after day, you did these funerals. And not only in Arlington, but out. We also did in the Washington, D.C. metro area. We would wear our green dress uniforms then. And one of the strange things is we would have funerals at black churches, and naturally the deceased would have been, was a black soldier. And these people put on tremendous services, and the wake afterwards, it was like we were long-lost relatives. They would give us food and chicken and all kinds of good food. So we always competed for black funerals. We always enjoyed that, but that was a kind of a sad thing because in Arlington, you were absolutely exhausted at the end of the day, and then you get back to your barracks, and it's just as hot. And I always kept the upper bunk because that's 1 degree cooler up there. You know, that's only
right.
5 feet up in the air, but we always said it's 1 degree cooler. And so it was not a pleasant.
And you're and you're under the uniforms weigh a lot, the shoes weigh a lot, and then the coffins weigh a lot. This is a very physically taxing.
Exactly. The Arlington did change, well, at least the old guard changed. Sometime in the late 80s, and they went to 8 guys on a funeral, on all funeral details, and they did away with the boots with the horseshoe plates on it. The dress shoes are still with horseshoe plates, but you don't train in horseshoe plates, which just, my feet are absolutely ruined from 3 straight years of every day, 6 days a week. Including days that we were in the city for riots, and we spent 11 days, 20-hour days in the city, wearing those miserable shoes.
Let's talk about those miserable shoes. For those who didn't, they look almost like normal shoes, but they're not quite. If you just saw them from afar, you'd say, "Oh, black dress shoes." Let's describe those shoes for me. We'll hopefully run those when we run in the newspaper, pictures of those. But now describe those for me, if you will.
Well, the first thing you would do is get a brand-new pair of shoes. And on a Saturday afternoon when you get off duty, you'd put them on your feet and then go into the latrine and soak your feet in a large tub of hot water with your shoes on. And then you do that for about an hour, and then you go and walk around, go to the movies, beer hall. You just do something. And you would wear them the next day. What happens is the leather gets close and shrinks next to your feet and conforms right to your feet. Then you let it dry for a week. We had an area up in the attic that you could dry your shoes. And then you would take fine coarse sandpaper or fine sandpaper and sandpaper your entire shoe so that the white's showing. And then you would use a prophylactic and dip it in paint, and you would paint your shoes, then sand it, paint your shoes. You would put 7 coats on. And the reason for that, and you did the same thing with your boots, if you had funerals, you couldn't go and change your shoes after each funeral, so your shoes would get wet with grass and mud and so forth on them, get back onto the bus, and you would carefully wipe your shoes off. And that way you would look good at the next funeral. And then about every 3 months you go and paint your shoes again. You had to have 2 pairs of shoes and 2 pairs of boots because you had to rotate them because otherwise your body sweat on your shoes would just rot the shoes in no time. And you would develop all kinds of diseases and so forth. But then at the same time, after you get the shoes painted, you would take them to the shoe shop, and you would have 2 full soles put on, a half sole, have the rubber heels taken off, and have a rock maple heel put on. You would have horseshoe plates put on, a toe tap put on, and then you would go back and you would buy 2 Stanley steel mending plates, and they were your heel clickers. You would go, and we had a vise, an anvil, hammers, and a drill in the basement, and you would go and spend a good part of an afternoon bending the Stanley mending plates until they would fit your inside heel. And then you would go and mount them and paint them black or use heel and sole, and so that you could get the nice heel click. They're exactly the same shoes that the guys at the Tomb of the Unknown wear.
It's the clickety-clack. But they're heavy-duty. They're not tap shoes. They are maple. I want to kind of stress that. They're maple heel, and then they almost look like a dress, a horseshoe. I mean, a steel horseshoe. And it's important that the pair that you brought in, on the rims or edges of the heel, you actually wore down the steel till yep. you got to that sole. That's how much you had used. That takes a lot of walking and a lot of standing to literally grind off steel. Standing all day. That just sounds incredibly uncomfortable.
You get used to it.
Yeah. These are wool uniforms?
They were light wool for summer, and the main uniform was fatigues that you trained in. You could not roll your sleeves up no matter how hot it was. They had to be freshly pressed every morning. And by the end of the day, of course, you had sweat stains and so forth. You would sweat through very easily because every time you got a drink of water, you had to take a salt tablet. That was the thought at the time. So at the end of the day, you have these white rings around your uniform. Can't press them, can't iron that out. You can't hand wash them. Got to take them to the cleaners, which was at that time, I think it was $1.50 a uniform, which was, when you're only making 79 bucks a month, that's good money or big money. And you go through that. It's either that or you go to Vietnam. Hmm. And so they had the famous sword of Demogenes hanging over your head.
Yeah. What was the so at a funeral? What did you do? What was your job as a honor guard?
Because let's say it was going to be a hearse.
Okay.
The hearse would pull up, doors would open, and we would have a six-man detail. We would do a movement and get behind the hearse. And because I was the short guy on the team, and at the end I was only 6'1". You would walk down between the other five guys, lift up the back of the flag on the casket, or if there wasn't a flag, if it was a drop job, you would grab hold of the handles, and you would slowly pull the coffin out. And as you pulled the coffin out, the rest of the guys on your funeral team would grab hold of the handles, provided there's handles. We had one that didn't, and that was really tricky to carry. We used leather straps for that. And then once everybody is set, you go and carry it in step to the gravesite, very carefully lower it onto the lowering device. And that was really the crucial time. Then you would carefully pick up the flag, hold it level. Some guys had to adjust. And we were very good at that. We held it very, very tight, six of us. And then after the priest said his stuff, we're still holding the flag, and they would have the firing party, which was seven guys and an NCO right behind us. And they would fire a 21-gun salute with M14s over our head, which is the reason I wear hearing aids now. Don't you dare flinch.
That's hard.
It's hard. You would warn the other, guns coming. You would be talking in your breath and so forth. And then they would fire the salute, 21-gun salute, and they were great. You'd only hear literally three shots because the guys were that good. And then the bugle would play, and we had buglers from the U.S. Army Band, which is stationed at Fort Myer. And then we would go and fold the flag, and there was a whole special routine to folding the flag so that it was made into a triangle and would have four stars showing and no red. And we practiced that and practiced that and practiced that and practiced that. And finally, after a year of hauling coffins around, there was an opening in marching platoon. So I went down to marching platoon because my back was really sore. And that you, let's say you have a full honor funeral, you have the caisson, six horses, the caparisoned horse, and then you're walking right behind the caisson. You have a platoon of, I would say it's 27 guys again. And as you're walking, you're stepping, the horses do what horses do, so you're stepping in that stuff and getting splattered with that stuff, with the horse apples. And then one day we had, this was in 69, we had a funeral, full honor funeral, where we went by the Custis Lee Mansion, and there's a spot where the hill goes downhill. And nobody realized it, but there was ice there. And next thing I know, the horse-drawn caisson is with the coffin on top is going sideways. The horses are going sideways. And suddenly, we're going sideways in one large mass of people. We stayed in formation. Nobody got out of step. But that was, nobody had ever seen that before. Hmm. We were literally sliding sideways, but still maintaining our military posture.
What happens if someone throws themselves on the coffin or is weeping on it? Then what do you do?
You halt, and hopefully the pastor or priest or whomever is there will have that person come off. It's very, very moving. But it's not unexpected. We've seen, you see so many of them during the course of a day that, you know, you don't want to say, get off of here or anything else like that. You just hold it in. And it is tough. And you feel for the guys, you know, who had passed away. It's such a death is such a terrible final thing, especially when you die for nothing. And they're saying, well, they died for their country. No, they didn't die for their country. They died because a politician made a, you know, terrible mistake. And I don't care if it's, in Vietnam or Afghanistan. You know, you're not fighting for anything.
Yeah.
It's a totally, the senselessness of it all is, we're just repeating the Civil War and World War I over and over and over again. What did they die for?
Yeah. What about you mentioned even something that it seems fairly commonplace, but what happens? So if bees came around and stung you, you just took it.
You took it. You didn't. And if you didn't get a bad reaction, we did towards in 68, we started getting a medic with us every time. And he made sure that we drank water. We had a cooler filled with canteens, your own canteen filled with ice water. You couldn't drink too much or you'd get cramps, but you'd get stung by bees all the time, or in my case, I get hit by a bird, but that was, and we had many guys pass out.
Yeah, what happens when that happened?
The NCOs who are stationed in certain areas on a formation, inside their glove, they carry an ammonia capsule. And so what they do, they see you go down and they smash the capsule. They had the gloved hands. They'd smash one capsule, go down, and put it in front of your face. And, of course, the ammonia wakes you right up. And then they drag you back up and see how you're doing and so forth. And if you just can't do it, we had medics behind the parade in spots back there. A medic would come over and grab that person, and you would simply have a blank spot in there. At Fort McNair in D.C. one time, we lost 14 guys, as I recall, in the heat. It was that bad. And we went through all kinds of precautions. You always moved your feet. You didn't lose. You kept loosey-goosey, we called. You know, you didn't get too tense or anything else. And there was all kinds of talk in the ranks. You wouldn't see it, but everybody's talking without moving, you know. Did you see that broad over there? Yeah, man, look at the rack on, you know, things like that. You had to do something to keep your mind.
Right. So if you did pass out, were you out, or did you get a talking to, or was that just part of the deal?
You might get a, you got a talking to. You might get an elbow to the ribs. You definitely did not pass out again. I get a little wavy one time, but I went and started moving my feet quite a bit, not so that anybody could see, and they got the blood circulating again. But when you're out there in that heat, and even though you drink water, we would drink so much water every day. Of course, it all flushes right out of your system. Your uniforms, after a while, develop a white patina to them, or it's a funny color, because you couldn't. You have two sets of summer dress uniforms, and you wear one day, and the other one's in the cleaners, and they suddenly pull another, funeral or surprise on you. You got to put this other one on that's white in color, so you take it down to the steam shop and press the salt back into the uniform. I mean, you do what you have to do. The pettiness was constant, but you learned to live with it.
Did you? Let's talk about too, because you were the honor guard. One of the things that a lot of the soldiers talk about when they're in there is maybe a few of them talk about either watching, getting news of riots that are going on in the States, or some of them worried about doing that. You actually, because you were the guard, because you were the old guard, that meant that you were the D.C. Army when things got bad, right? The D.C. Guard when things got bad, and there was riots in 68, I want to say?
Yeah, when Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated, D.C. had one of the worst riots. Our company happened to be Ready Company. We were the very first unit in. Shortly after the riots began, and then we were moved to Cardosa High School, which is a school in the inner city, and we slept in the boys' locker room. That's where we kept our gear. But we patrolled. I was at 10th and Massachusetts Avenue with a three-man crew, full field gear, rifles, bloopers, and so forth, but no ammunition. We got shot at a couple times, but the local, the Metropolitan Police for the district went and handled that. And we were there 11 straight days. We ate pretty well. The cooks were out there every day with good breakfasts and good food and so forth. So that wasn't a problem. And then in the evening, they would put two of us soldiers in the back of a Metropolitan Police car. And if they stopped anybody, we would get out with the police and handle. But that gave us a chance at least to sleep. And because the officers were just as tired, so we would find, some alley or something else, and all four of us would go sound asleep.
Wow. But was that a scary time working the riots?
Well, you didn't know if, for the most part, the riots were over by the time we got there. They burned the liquor stores, they burned some of the drug stores, and some of the, mom-and-pop operations. A few apartment houses. but then it was over. Our biggest fear was the anti-Vietnam demonstrations. In fact, that's how I found out about White House Police. They put my company in the basement of a building next to the White House, and I saw these guys walking around, and they turned out to be White House Police. So I got the recruiting literature and would later go, and after I got out of the Army, I went to White House Police. But you didn't know what they were going to do. Would they jump the fence? Because the fence is easily climbable. It happens all the time. Would they try to take over the White House, which would not be the hardest thing in the world, at least at that time? They might have all kinds of different violence and so forth. But we practiced for riot control, which was you go in a V-shaped formation with bayonets and so forth. And that always seemed like bayonets and your civilians. It does not seem like a good mix, but we never had to do that.
Right.
Fortunately, but...
Yeah. When you were, did you ever have, sometimes today we hear about protesters at funerals. When you were burying Vietnam vets, was there any protest? Did you ever have to deal with that?
No, never any protest. Only the highest level of respect. either at Arlington or outside of Arlington. There was no demonstrations against it or anything else. It was just pure, absolute grief on the part of the families involved, and which is, you know, totally understandable. You know, a young man given his life and in such, you know, terrible conditions and so forth. You felt sorry for the guy, but then, you know, you got the burning thing in your chest going, why? But you readily accept that's some kind of form of life that you have to have.
Yeah. Did you, and so as you're doing this, is there any discussion of what's going on in Vietnam, or is this just part of what you do almost by routine?
Okay. But yeah, we would, in the day room, you'd have a newspaper. Most of the guys went and grabbed the crosswords and, you know, did that. We were hearing some of the stuff going on over there, but we knew the futility of it. We knew these guys were, in some areas, getting massacred. You get something like Hamburger Hill, where they went and charged the hill. A lot of Americans were killed, and then the next day they abandoned the hill. What gives? Why?
Right. Right, yeah.
It sounds like the stupidity of World War One and the trench warfare and so forth.
Right. Two steps forward, one step back.
Yeah. And then you get the mass funerals, or, you know, and I'll never forget burying the left hand. That's going to be, you know, in my mind all my life. But it's sad. But we had to, you know, go about our lives, even though, you know, it crushed us when we saw these things. Young people, young men, our buddies. I knew a guy from Basic, a couple guys from Basic we buried. Hmm. And holy mackerel, why?
Yeah, because how old are you at this time? I mean, when you're...
I'm, at that time, I... 20? 18 to 21.
Right.
And that was 46, 47 years ago. But...
How often did you have to practice? I mean, because you have to practice at this. You just don't do formation or learn how to fold a flag correctly. How often do you spend practicing, and what's practice? It sounds weird. We're practicing for a funeral or a parade. I mean... But yet you do. You have to. So tell me about that.
Well, we had training coffins, and some of them were loaded with cinder blocks to give the weight. Others, fortunately, weren't. So you would practice with these coffins and fold the flag. And we had mock-up lowering devices. And then that would be a... Just for a couple hours. The rest of the time you spent marching, and you had to be absolutely perfect when you marched. And there's a lot of roads in Arlington and at Fort Myer, and you would simply march and march and march and march, and you became so good at it, you know, you could do it, you know, by memory. And nothing fancy, simply they drill into your head. Example two, with a firing party, they would be off to their own separate area. They wouldn't fire rounds. You don't fire that in an urban area like Arlington, Virginia. But they would go and practice and practice and practice. And those guys were good. They knew, all seven guys would know exactly what the other guy's doing. And so it was very rare for you to hear bang, bang. You would hear simply a bang. A bang and a bang. And that meant 21 shots. They were that good. But our unit also, not our company, but our unit had, I guess we've got 10 cannon. They were 75-millimeter cannon. They didn't fire any rounds. They fired blanks. But for state funerals, arrival ceremonies, and so forth, they had that. Plus, of course, we had the horses. Mm-hmm. We had the only unit in the Army, I think, that still maintains active couriers, people who shoe horses and stuff like that. That was an actual military specialty. But I don't know if there's a specialty for shoveling poop. Who knows? But
right, an MOS for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but we didn't have, but they were their own separate area. They did their job. They left us alone. and we left them alone. And for the most part, everybody kind of got along real well as so far as.
There's all kinds of different weather there. We think, I mean, I think of Washington, D.C. as hot and sticky, and but I also know it can be cold and there can be snow. There can also be rain. What did you do in those other weather conditions?
You got wet.
Okay.
You did it. You had either your raincoats, which naturally weren't the best quality. We finally got overcoats in the latter part of 68, which were nice, but then again you had to, you literally, it wore you. You didn't wear it. And everything was form-fitted. And, of course, walking on ice with steel shoes is a lot of fun. So you have to be very, very careful. You have to keep straight ahead, but you develop great peripheral vision so that you know where your feet are going. That's because one of the things, training, behind all of our barracks, we had a foot-long concrete wall, which was about 2 feet off. It separated two drive spaces. And you would learn to walk that wall without ever looking down. 1 foot in front of the other, carrying your pan of water, no bouncy or anything else. It was about 100 yards long, and then you did your turnaround without getting off, proper turn, and come back. And you would do that all day or for an hour, and then you would do something else.
Wow. So there's just constant drilling.
Constant.
So you would drill the flags, you would drill marching. What else are there other things? Tell me what else you drill.
You would learn how to pick up a coffin fully loaded with cinder blocks over your head. Because you had a full honor ceremony with a caisson, that caisson is not low to the ground. You would actually have to raise the entire coffin straight up in the air, and then you slide it onto the top of the caisson behind the horses. And that's not a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Or if you're going up church steps, you want to keep that coffin level. So I'm the short guy. I'm at the back end, so I've got to have my hand straight up in the air with my buddy next to me. We got to keep that coffin up. Meanwhile, at the front, those guys have to walk along with the coffin down like this. If you notice Ronald Reagan's funeral where they carried his oak coffin, it took 32 guys to carry his coffin up the steps. That's because it's so bloody heavy. They can only do about 10, 15 steps. Then they have another funeral team, a fresh funeral team. There they go and switch off. That team carries it up to the next step. Like I'm saying, grand total, there was 8 guys and 6 teams, 32 guys to carry one coffin. I would have said, put it on the elevator.
Right. Did any of this thing, I mean, I know it made, you said that it made so little sense that some guy said, oh, fine, I'm just going to Vietnam. But did the Army ever explain why it did all of this? Or were you just, could you even ask? Could you say, why do we do it like this?
You'd get an elbow to the side.
Right. I would have had a lot of, my ribs would have been constantly sore. Yeah. Or I would have been in Vietnam. I'm sure.
Well, and then a couple weeks later, you're in the ground. And, you saw this and you learned real quick. If you want to be very dead, then go to Vietnam. If you want to, do your best to stay alive, do what they say. Do what they yell at. Put up with the trash can flying across the floor at 3 a.m.
Yeah.
Yeah, or go into the latrine or here's a good one. One morning, I'm charge of quarters as a buck sergeant, and I'm in charge of the building because I'm the only one there or only person of any rank. 2 MPs show up at the door, and between these 2 MPs, they have one of guys, and he's dead drunk, and he's hanging like this. Then an MP captain walks in, and then right behind him is a man in gray hair, thin, wearing a Hawaiian shirt. And it's General William C. Westmoreland. Well, what had happened is this guy had been to a party in Arlington, and instead of walking all the way to the main gate, he climbed over the fence, which is at Quarters Number 1, which is the Army Chief of Staff, who happened to be Westmoreland. And Westmoreland went out for his morning constitutional and finds this guy passed out on his lawn. Puts two and two together, gets the MPs down there. They find out where he's at, and sure enough, they show up in my barracks. And so I've got the Army Chief of Staff yelling at me. And he wants the colonel, he wants the sergeant major and everybody else. So I'm there feverishly making phone calls. And they disappeared this guy. We have guys sometimes would show up one morning and, maybe he, let's say he didn't change his T-shirt. He had a kind of a grody T-shirt on. He would disappear right to Vietnam. And that's the same way they had with this kid who was drunk. Right to Vietnam.
So if you show up drunk on Westmoreland's lawn, your punishment is Westmoreland's war?
Yep. Yep.
Yeah. Is there ever, and maybe this is a horrific question to even ask, but you're doing a lot of these, you're tired, the heat or the cold can be unbearable. Do you ever drop coffins? Do you ever do it? Did it ever happen?
Not our company. D Company, in one day, the coffin and the six guys carrying the coffin all went into the hole.
Because it caved?
The 2x4s that Arlington would put down on either side, and then they put this green rug-like on top. All of that, the sides collapsed, and then it was just the first guy goes in, second guy goes in, coffin goes in. And it took them a while to get it out, and then they had a funeral director there, I guess, worked on the body, and then they had to bring in more wood, and it was really but the guys got blamed for it, the funeral team, because they weren't careful enough. And so they were banned for a week, and literally, that was from D Company, a sister company, and every now and then you could see them running down the back road behind our barracks with a coffin over their head so that they learned not to drop another coffin. It was their fault, like the bird pooping on my hat was my fault, that because I flinched. But you didn't flinch anymore.
I guess. what about the... and in weather, they just didn't. Was there any time that you didn't do a funeral or a parade because of weather? Was there any condition too bad not to do?
Later during Reagan's time, they canceled his inauguration, but that was many years later. No, if it was scheduled, we went on. We went on in mini blizzards. Nothing super heavy where they would close the whole town down. But you were in snow and ice and. Or 105 degree temperature, it didn't matter. You did what you had to do.
What happens, did anybody try to talk to you during those funerals?
The people?
Yeah.
No.
They just let you do
it? We kept, of course, we weren't going to engage in anything. We would usually have a senior NCO with us, and he would, do the talking, but he had, also done hundreds of these. And if there's any talking, the chaplain could talk to them, or many times there would be a senior officer would talk to them.
So you did this for 3 years. How many funerals would you say you did?
Well, I lost track at 500. Had a way of marking on our suspenders, like a blue dot was a drop job, a pink drop was a kid, a diamond was a full honor, a blue triangle was a Vietnam guy. And so my suspenders got filled up and I stopped counting. So, and it, of course, you go from a Vietnam funeral and the next thing you know, you bury two babies. And, you still have six guys, but only, one guy carries the coffin and so forth. So that tears you up.
Yeah. How did you deal? How did this doing this job? How did it affect your life?
It probably affected me mentally, as far as depression goes. Mm-hmm. It made me angry. Fortunately, I've got a wonderful wife, and she understands what I went through because she, you know, saw me going through a lot of this stuff, and she's been my rock on all of this. And I've got two wonderful daughters and two wonderful son-in-laws and two marvelous grandchildren. So, you know, family is everything. And we've had our ups and downs, but mm-hmm. wife and I have only been married 47 years. So, when I went to Secret Service a few months later, I could use that anger and so forth and direct it as a good actor would. Let's say if you have a demonstrator at the White House and he's ready to climb over the fence, you know, you persuade him in certain ways he's not going to do that. But at the same token, if you've got a family from Kalamazoo, Michigan, and they want to see the White House and they want to know what happened in the dome on top, you got to tell them that's the Capitol building, this is the White House.
Right.
So, yeah.
So you found a different job that helped.
But you still get to yell at people occasionally.
Give them a rib. Yeah. Obviously what you did affected how you saw the Vietnam War. Even though you never were there, you probably in certain respects saw some realities that other people never did. How did what you did here very much stateside affect how you saw Vietnam?
It still affected me as to, I should have gone. But at the same token, I remember the guys who went, and they're very dead. I wouldn't have seen, you know, or been a father. It was extremely rough with the constant burials. Mm-hmm. And because I came from a family where my dad had been a hero in World War II, 82nd Airborne, Battle of the Bulge, and kind of stuff. And I wanted to be like him, but this wasn't, you know, when the reality of war is these guys are here dead, they're going to be dead for a long time, and many of them die such, you know, in so many horrible ways, and it just, we didn't have words for it.
Did your father have concerns being who he was? Did he have concerns when you went into the Army during a time of war?
He was very happy that I went to the Army Honor Guard and not to Vietnam. He says, we're wasting lives over there. We're wasting trillions of dollars. And it turned out we were. We got 58,000 guys in the ground and nothing to show for it. I mean, Vietnam is now a retirement location for a lot of people. What is wrong with this picture?
Yeah.
You know, it's still a communist country. It's still, we achieved absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
We wasted lives, and it was just, you can't explain it. The terrible conditions that the guys, you know, lived in. Many of them went through substance abuse. There were so many mental illness cases. I used to walk every day in power walking by the Vietnam Memorial, and I would see all the names on there and the guys that I knew. I would, you know, just run my fingers along their names and so forth. And that's all they have for their life is a little name engraved on a wall. That's it. They had no life, no family, no loves, no hates.
Yeah.
You know, what could these 48,000 guys could have given America? Maybe one of them could have invented the cure for cancer. God, what a waste.
Yeah. Does it, looking forward, what do you hope people who go back and look at the Vietnam era remember from some guy who was a part of that? You obviously weren't in Vietnam, but you saw a very different side of that, and you were part of the military during Vietnam. What do you hope they remember?
that war is generally totally, totally senseless. It achieves absolutely nothing. Waste billions of dollars, not even to count the innocent lives on both sides that are lost. And to see the, you know, the guys coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan and so forth, and they're, sometimes you almost wish that they had died over there, and that's terrible, but the pain, the carnage.
Yeah, so you see a parallel even between what's going on there and Vietnam. I mean, there is a parallel.
I had an Afghan neighbor back in Virginia, and he said, John, he says, you put two Afghans in a room, you're going to come out with three political parties. And I learned a lot from, his name was Mohammed. He says, you know, he also talked to me about the Muslim religion and so forth like that. And so I don't want to get into that, but, you know, the Russians had fought there, the British had fought there. In fact, we should have learned from the British, because at Basra is a huge military cemetery with 40,000 British soldiers there who died before World War II and during World War II. Maybe our commander should have walked through that cemetery first and seen the waste before they started sending our guys there.
Yeah, yeah. When you were at Arlington, what was the most interesting thing you saw there?
The Kennedy funeral. And, well, the Eisenhower funeral, too, but that was, at least they buried him in a simple aluminum casket. Nothing. Kennedy's buried in mahogany or oak. I'm glad I didn't have to carry it. But, yeah, the Kennedy, and it was displayed, you know, before us. And I've got my nine guys. And we're standing there simply watching history unfold in front of us. Very, very fascinating.
Hmm. What made that fascinating? That
The whole, you know, you're watching a world event. And because only a few years previously, I had been at home watching John Kennedy get buried. And now here I am watching Robert Kennedy get buried after assassination. And then in the other sad thing was December 24th, 1968, when I performed at the funeral for my father in Section 53. And he was only 52 years old when he died. So,
how do you perform now you're not supposed to show any emotion, and you're doing this as a professional soldier, but you're also a son. How do you do that?
You just stare straight ahead. I was given because I had just made buck sergeant, I was given I had been a buck sergeant for a while, I was permitted to carry a sword you know, present the salute with the sword that way. I could show no reaction, no tears. Couldn't do that.
For your own father.
For my own father. You know, later, of course, the tears would come out and so forth.
What do you think he would have thought?
I think he would have been proud.
Mm-hmm.
I know he didn't. He was the one who did not want me to go to Vietnam. He says, you know, all war is a waste. He had seen that. And he was an old, tough son of a gun.
Mm-hmm.
He had, at one point, had a bayonet go in his mouth and out the side and took some teeth. And
that's tough.
And, yeah, and they put they stitched him up, put a bandage on, says, okay, you're going back to America. And so he turned around, went back to his unit, and the bandage froze to his face, prevented infection. That's the kind of guy he was. So, you know, yeah, I love my father, love my mother. You don't show tears.
Hmm.
Yeah, for, you know, anything like that.
Hmm. Was it, did you know you were going to get your father's funeral?
It was quite sudden. And now I was Army and he was buried by Air Force, but I was still part of the funeral team.
Hmm.
And parts of my company and my platoon were there to show respect and to show, you know, camaraderie with me. Hmm. But yeah, that was tough.
Wow. And on Christmas too.
Christmas Eve, 1968.
Yeah. Yeah. Is it was it so the tenor of the military funerals would change with depending on if they were older or Vietnam too. Was there anything about the ceremonies if you were killed in combat and young? Was the ceremony the same for everyone?
Was it basically the same for everybody? Usually, of course, you have a military chaplain there, or a local pastor if he was from the area, or you had the bugler and the firing party. When you got up higher in rank, colonel and above are called flag ranks, because when they're promoted, they're given their own personal flag. And so when you do one of their funerals, you've got to assign another guy to carry the personal colors. And so he's got to carry the flag wherever, you know, two stars or one star or whatever it is. So that's another one of the, you know, little ceremonies that's involved. Hmm. You know, so, but you do what you have to do, and you don't... you don't worry about tomorrow. It's going to come whether you like it or not. You just go and do your job now. Do the best you can, because you don't want to be, you know, chastised for that. And I must have done well, and because I made buck sergeant early, acting buck sergeant, and then regular buck sergeant. And I think if I had stayed in a little bit longer, they would have been an automatic staff sergeant, but I had the chance for White House police coming up, and, you know, working at the White House was something I could never have dreamed of in my entire life.
Right.
And
was it hard making that transition from Arlington to the White House?
It was from going from very professional soldiers in a very professional and disciplined environment to an environment filled with not the brightest guys in the world. Many of them had been kicked off of other police departments, and this was their last resort. A lot of mental cases, alcoholics, but it's still double what I was making in the Army.
Right.
And we had just had a little baby, and in fact, she's the one who's doing that court right now, that murder trial. So, yeah. It was worth it.
Wow. So what have we've talked for a while. What have I missed about either your life as as one of the honor guards or your life in the military?
When I went into to Fort Benning, I was a cocky little punk. The world revolved around me. And I had a succession of fine drill sergeants quickly change my mind. I don't care how it was done, with a slap to the face or a jolt to the ribs. They got my attention real quick, and I realized I better follow their instructions to the letter. And I did. And, you know, you learn all the necessary things. Sometimes you go and do a little bit of extra. I would maybe read the Army Times at the PX or something like that to pick up just a little bit of extra. Not that I intended to make it a career, it helped. It did. Not that my life was, you know, everybody's life in the old guard was rough, but you still had the sense, much like the Marines do, of their heritage and our heritage. On the military uniform of the old guard, they wear what is called a buff strap, and it's just a little piece of leather that goes down. But that's the one thing I want to take with me to my grave, will be my buff strap, because I did put up with the most, you know, physical exercise, abuse, emotional abuse, psychological, you name it, but you still make it through. You just kind of go. In the Army, we had a strange saying, and it was in all branches of the Army. They can kill you, but they can't eat you. And somehow it doesn't make any sense until you're there and you're in the worst area. You know, I don't care if you're crawling an obstacle course through pig guts. You would think to yourself, they can kill you, but they can't eat you. And somehow that made it all much better. I have no idea why. Maybe I ought to talk to a psychologist about that.
No, I think I get where you're coming from. Yeah. And so that buff strap, that's the old uniform. That's normal, yeah. But that was part of your heritage.
Yeah, well, what it was from during colonial days, they would use the buff strap to polish their buttons, their brass buttons. Mm-hmm. So now it is part of, and only the old guard can wear it. It's a little piece of leather, dark brown with little light brown marks on it, and it symbolizes the buff strap. But that's, you know, you wear the buff strap, and that is, you know, you've earned it.
Yeah. Was it a, last question, was it a happy thing to be done with the Army, with the
I'm
old
glad
guard?
I went through it. I wouldn't want to go through it again, but I did it. I can't ever go back to the past. Wonderful memories now that I've been away for a while. In fact, every now and then I go to Google Earth, and I'll go back and I'll visit my company again. And that wall is still there behind the 1 foot wall where they say, go and walk the wall for an hour. You go and walk the wall for an hour. Sometimes with the AM-14, sometimes without.
Just for an hour. And what do you think about during that hour?
You think about your... making sure that your feet, you know where your feet are every second, because you don't want to slip, because don't forget you get, you know, steel shoes. So you walk, and you walk briskly, too. It's none of this 1 foot after the other kind of thing. You will walk at a normal pace. And any one of the NCOs passing by can chew you out if you're not doing properly. You know, something proper. If you're not keeping an eye on your weapon, you know, you have to hold and just, I've got a permanent groove right here.
Wow.
Yeah. So it was quite an experience.
Yeah. What was the best? You said I've got some good memories. You know, we've heard some of the tough ones. What's the best memory you take from that?
Probably meeting my wife.
Okay.
Because she's been a tremendous friend. Birth of our daughter. I had some good friends I've met in there. Everybody after a while, you became very close because you're in a room about this size and there's like 10 of you and you sit there and, you know, play cards or tell stories or polish brass.
Wow.
Polished brass.
Your best dressed unit in the whole Army.
Well, yeah, and learn how to shave your ears. That's kind of, it's tricky. We had a guy try Nair one time. Burned the heck out of his ears. Yeah.
But all kinds of trivia.
In the morning, 5:30 a.m., you're out there in formation, and the first sergeant would come along with his credit card. And he would look at your face, and he would take the credit card and flip your face. And if he could hear the whiskers, that meant you hadn't shaved. So you went back in. First, you did 20 push-ups. Went back in and shaved and no breakfast again. So you double shaved. You shaved at night, and then you double shaved in the morning.
Wow.
But it was normal. You did it. You did it automatically so that you could get on and... You know, any day that you're not, don't get your ass chewed out, is a good day.
About how often would you?
Oh, we'd get it chewed out simply for breathing, you know, sometimes.
Right.
And I look back, I used the internet and I found my old first sergeant's address. He lives in northern Louisiana. He's got a strange name, so I know it's him. And I sent him a thank you card. Basically, thank you for being an SOB. Because, you know, And I look at my dad changing my life and my first sergeant changing my life. And a succession of very angry NCOs also in my life. There's a movie out called Gardens of Stone with James Caan, James Earl Jones, Angelica Houston, and so forth. And it's about the old guard. And there's one scene in there where there's a first sergeant does the, he walks into the room and this first sergeant screaming every kind of obscenity in the world. That was my life. Yeah, it also stars D.B. Sweeney and Mary Stuart Masterson, Gardens of Stone. And it deals 1968 at the Old Guard and the funerals we did and so forth.
Wow. So, Does not sound like, I want to say, first of all, thank you for doing that. Thank you for seeing that, and thank you for serving, because that's that sounds like a miserable duty, but having watched the ceremonies, very touching and very powerful, too. So thank you for being a part of it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I always felt honored by doing it, even though at the time you sometimes wondered if, you know, your mind was set screwed on straight. Right. I was surprised we didn't have more desertions or AWOLs, honestly. Right. The only AWOLs we had were from the professional PFCs who had 20 years in it. They wouldn't show up on a Monday because they're still on a bender somewhere. But, we had retirement ceremonies, believe it or not, where we retired private E1s with 20-year service. They had been up and down the ranks so often. We had a supply sergeant who was a staff sergeant, and his combat patch that he wore was from Normandy. But he had been up and down.
Wow.
One point he makes platoon sergeant, the next day he's a PFC. Nowadays, that wouldn't be permitted in the Army, but then, it wasn't at all unusual. They wanted these professional soldiers.
And they just go up and down depending on what the benders or how sober they wanted to stay or what they did.
I remember even an acting NCO, you had to go to the NCO club on Friday nights and have a beer. And I remember sitting in the back because that's where all the young guys, we did not want to get close to these old guys with all of the medals and stuff. Remember my first sergeant pulling up a chair next to him playing cards. He puts a case of beer down. He drinks that whole case. Never takes a pee. I figure I had to salute that guy.
Hey, well, this has been Darrell Ehrlich with John E. Howard. I've had a great this has been really fascinating and also pretty powerful. Thank you for tuning in and listening. Thank you, John, for being here. It's been my honor. This is Darrell Ehrlich with Vietnam Voices, a project of the Billings Gazette, sponsored by Master Lube.